But first, are there any questions? Yes, here in the front. Just wait for the mic. Thanks.
Curious about his language and if he traveled all across the world and he spoke in all different countries, what did he speak mostly when he was lecturing?
Well, he spoke a lot in English, but you needed subtitles to understand him. And the reason why was because when his father was in this prisoner of war camp for 6.5 years, he taught himself English by reading a book. And then he taught Paul English. So if you learn English from someone who's never heard an English speaker, it gets pretty jarbled, garbled. How about one last question? Yes.
Do you think Fermat really had a proof of his last theorem?
Well, my first job out of college was at Scientific American, where I edited a famous mathematical games column by Martin Gardner. And half of the mail I had to open on behalf of Martin were people that thought they had proofs of Fermat's last theorem. I doubt it. Lots of smart people have looked at it over the years. Maybe he thought he had it and made a mistake, but nobody knows. You know, one thing about mathematics is mathematicians are very passionate. Okay? You may think that even though Paul wanted problems to be solved, there are many mathematicians that aren't as generous with their results. There were fights between Newton and Leibniz. There were fights all along in mathematics because people care. All right, our next speaker is Joel Spencer. Joel worked very closely with Erdős. They wrote 23 papers together, the first in 1972. He's a professor here at the Courant Institute in NYU. He was very helpful and generous with his time when I was working on the book. He helped me understand a lot of the mathematics. And I remember something that Joel told me. He told me that even when he was young, he thought that mathematics was about adding up columns of numbers, that your father was a CPA, I think, and that's a lot of what you do when you're a CPA. But it was in high school that he began to realize that it was something more than that. And then I remember you quipped that as an adult, if you had continued adding up large strings of number, you might be a lot richer. Maybe richer financially, but not richer in the beauty that you've seen in this world and that the beauty you've been able to bring to it by solving mathematical conjecture. So Joel Spencer.
Thank you, Paul. It's always wonderful to hear stories about Paul, who I knew for really my entire professional life. There are decks of cards being passed around now, and I'll ask, they're going to every other person, because this will be a two-person card game. I'll ask that you open up the deck, but do not shuffle the deck, please. Just simply remove the jokers or whatever special cards there are so that you'll be left with a deck of precisely 52 cards, but keep them, please, in their standard order, and then we'll look at a game that we'll play. But first, I want to go back to 1931. Three young people walked in the beautiful hill country of Budapest and talked about mathematics, Esther Klein, George Sekeres, and the youngster, the 18-year-old Paul Erdős. And they were working on a problem of Esther Klein. And Paul Erdős came up with what mathematicians call a lemma. A lemma usually is something that's then used to prove the problem that Klein proposed. But in this case, the lemma, the theorem has survived too, but the lemma has survived and is now considered a very important theorem in its own right. And so I'd like to show you a little bit about it and give a sense of what mathematics is about. If I can figure out this pen, then I'll be able to do it. So it's called the monotone subsequence theorem. And this is not the number of Rubik's cubes. This is a sequence of numbers from 0 to 9. And the result in this special case is that no matter how you have the numbers from 0 to 9 in any order, some four of them will be what's called monotonic. But that's a mathematician's word for either going up or going down. They don't have to be right next to each other, but you'll have either four going up or four going down, and you might have both. In this particular case, there are several cases, several examples, but here's one. 8653 is going down. Now, the theorem is not just for 0 through 9. It's really for any square. If you have the numbers from 0 to n square, then you get a sequence whose length is n plus 1. So if you had a sequence of the numbers from 0 to 100, you'd have 11 of them going up and down. But let's just do it for 9. This was the result for the general value of n. I mean, for 9, you could look at all, maybe Paul can tell us how many cases there were, all the cases, and you could find them. Certainly a computer could do it. But the argument that I'm going to show you will work for all n. And this was the problem Paul did, and I want to indicate the idea of the argument. I'm going to take each number in the sequence, and I'm going to look at the longest increasing sequence I can get starting from that number. And I'm also going to look at the longest decreasing sequence I can get starting from that number, and then I'll place that into this grid. Now, if it doesn't go into this grid, which is going 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, then I'll be done, because I'll have something where the increasing sequence is length 4. That's what I'm trying to show, is that I can't do this, that it won't work. Well, let's start it out. Let's start from the right, because it's easy. If you start with 4, you can't do anything, because you're already at the end of the sequence. So the longest increasing is 1. Because you have 4 itself, you count it. And the longest decreasing is 1. So here's the increasing is 1. The decreasing is 1. It goes here. From 7, increasing, you can't do anything. The increasing is 1, but the decreasing is 2. You can go 7, 4. So the 7 goes here. Now what about the 3? From 3 you can go increasing, you can go 3, 7, but decreasing, you can't do anything. So the 3 goes here. And when you work this out, the 9 goes here, and the 0 goes here, and the 5 goes here, and the 6 goes here, and the 1 goes here, and the 2 goes here. And where is the 8 going to go? Well, it turns out the 8 goes over here. Now, this isn't yet a mathematical argument, because it looks like you say, well, there are 10 numbers and there are only 9 spots, but how do you know that each number went into a different spot? How do you know you couldn't have had, you know, this number go here and then some other number go to the same place? And this is the key to the mathematical argument, the key lemma to this lemma, is that when you do this and put them in the spots, no two numbers are ever going to go to the same spot. So let me try and show that a little bit. And while I'm just giving an example, this is really an argument. So let me repeat the numbers again. 8, 2, 1, 6, 5, 0, 9, 3, 7, 4. And let's take 2 of the numbers. Let me take 2 and 6, and I want to give an argument why they can't end up in the same spot. Of course, they didn't end up in the same spot, but this argument will work in general. Now, as it happens here, the smaller number came first. So when the smaller number comes first, what we do is we look at the biggest increase. If the smaller number came first, we only look at increasing sequences. Turns out if the bigger number comes first, you look at the other way. Smaller number comes first, you look at the longest increasing sequence. From 6, it happens to be 6-9. Or it's 6-7, but they're the same length. So you've got 2 in a row, 6-9. How about starting at 2? Well, I can get more than 2 because I can stick the 2 in front of the 6-9, and that gives me a longer sequence. So the 2 and the 6 can't go into the same place. However long a sequence you can find starting with 6, you can prepend, except that's not a word. You can prepend 2, and then you get a longer one starting from 2. So they can't go into the same increasing number. And the argument, if the first one is bigger than the other, you make a similar argument with decreasing. And that's a mathematical proof. It's not counting up large numbers of numbers. In fact, it really doesn't have any calculation at all. That's what mathematics is. It's just thinking and coming up with logical arguments. And I'm so glad Paul Hoffman gave the example of the twin primes, and we didn't plan this in advance because that was my introduction. And I was 15, 16, something like that, and I had a wonderful high school teacher, and all of us, you know, if you're lucky enough to have a really great high school teacher, it lasts you your whole life. And he told us about the twin prime conjecture. And I realized this is a truth. That is, either there are an infinite number of twin primes, or they're not an infinite number of twin primes. And what's the answer? We don't know. We didn't know when I was in high school, and we still don't know the answer. But I have faith. I have faith the answer is either yes or no. And it doesn't matter if you're a biologist, you know, why have carbon-based life? Why not have silicon-based life? If you're a physicist, why not have inverse cube law? But in mathematics, that's it. Whichever way it is, it'll be the same way in another planet, in another universe. It's as absolute as you can get. And this is a real driving force. And being around Paul, it was something, you had it before you met Paul, but it was really strengthened being with him. So let's play some games. Let's take out the deck of cards, and please do not shuffle the cards, but I believe there are a couple of jokers there. Let me make sure I've got the deck, and keep them in order. And we're going to play what's called a liar game. There are going to be two players, so please work yourself up in pairs. If you want to have a trio and one person kibitz, that's perfectly okay. But somebody to either your left or your right has a deck of cards, so please pick a partner, and then I'll explain the game, and I'll invite you all to play it. And then I will play a game with a young companion up here, Connor, who's right here. Connor, you want to come up? You can notice the resemblance to the Terminator, Connor, right here. So we will play a game, and the two players are not going to be called Joel and Connor. But actually, they're going to be called Paul, who is going to ask the questions, because Paul was the great question asker. Paul Erdős not only proved theorems, but he made conjectures. He was always asking. And I'll leave this open for a while about why I'm using this name. The other player's name will be Carol, but Carol with an E, with an E. So this is the game. Here is a deck of cards, and I am going to try to guess the card. You will be Carol, and I will be Paul for this. And I am going to guess a card, and I'm going to have 9 questions. So Connor, so you have to pick with your, who will be Paul the questioner and who will be thinking of a card. So Connor, I want you to think of a card, but don't tell me. Don't tell me at all. Actually, maybe we can work it out so he can tell the, write it on something and tell the audience so I won't know. That would be good. Okay? So you think of a card. Now, but there's a kicker. There's a kicker. Connor is a very honest young man. However, in this game, he is allowed to lie. So I will ask him questions, and he is allowed to lie. However, there's a limitation. Some people call this the diplomat's game. You're allowed to lie, but you're only allowed to lie once. That's it. So you've got your card, and I'm going to start asking you questions about it. And maybe you can tell the audience what the card is, and I will just talk over here so I won't see it. This has not been rehearsed before. You can write down the card and then show it to the audience. But if he does lie, please don't all break out in laughter, or rather, if he doesn't lie, maybe you should break out in laughter to confuse me, however you want to do it. Now, here's how we're going to keep track of what's going on, because it's a little confusing about what's going on. I'm going to keep 2 piles of cards. At the start, all the cards are together. When I ask a question, the ones that I would normally throw out, instead of throwing out, I don't totally throw them out. I put them in what I call the fingernail pile. So I've got the main pile and the fingernail pile. So the fingernail pile is those cards. Well, very unlikely, but maybe Connor lied on that question. Okay. Now, then when I ask another question, if something's in the fingernail pile, it gets thrown out. So I'll just put it in my pocket or something like that. And the ones in the main pile, they don't get thrown out. If they're the right answer, you keep them. If they're the wrong answer, you move them to the fingernail pile. So maybe we can show this to the audience, if you can. But don't say a word. And I have 9 questions, and I'll start with the first 2 questions so that you can get the hang of it. In fact, I'll write down the questions over here. And let me suggest that these, you can ask whatever questions you want if you're Paul, but let me suggest that these are 2 questions. So my first question is it what in bridge is called a major suit? That is it either, if it's either a heart or a spade, those are called major suits. So Connor, is it either a heart, is it either a heart or a spade? So yes, don't tell me which one it is, and of course you might be lying anyway. Is it a major suit? It's a tough one. Go ahead.
Yes.
Yes, okay. Well, that's good to know. So now what I will do is here are the major, this is why I like these first 2 questions, because the cards are in order. So this is my main group, and the other ones I don't throw away, I'm going to keep here in my fingernail pile, okay? This is the main group, but those are still, they're not yet thrown away. For my second question, I'm going to say, is it a black card? The black cards are spades and clubs.
Yeah.
Well, that's good to know. So I keep, now here's what happens. First I go to the fingernail pile, and he said that it was black, so all the red ones just get thrown out, except that the museum will be rather unhappy if you really throw them out, so keep them somewhere for you. But these, and these black ones stay in the fingernail pile. And then I keep the black ones here. And these red ones I put in the fingernail pile. So now I've got some cards that were thrown out. So I really just have two piles. This is my main pile that has these 13 cards. And then I've got about 26 cards left. So let me invite you, while I'm doing this at the same time, just ask some questions of each other and work out the cards. In fact, why don't you start and we'll take a little bit of a break and I'll think of a good question. But we can do it at the same time. Well, this is good. And if there are any questions, just come up and ask. So my third question, I don't quite trust Connor. I'm going to ask, is it a spade?
No.
Oh. The question was, is it a spade? And the answer was no. So these, so now what happens, these are still all okay, and these all went into the fingernail pile. Now at this point, all I have is the fingernail pile, and let's see what happens. I've got 39 cards left, but I know you can't lie anymore, because I know you already lied. You said yes. It said spade is no, so it can't be, you must have lied because it wouldn't be a spade and it wouldn't be a club because you said this. So you have already lied and I've got 39 questions to go. So, no, sorry, I've got 39 cards to go, excuse me, and six questions, that would be good. So I'm just going to split them in half each time because I know he has to tell the truth. So I'll just say, is it in this pile? And I know you have to tell the truth. You can look at this pile. I'll hold this for you.
No.
Okay, so I'll throw these out. And now I'll break these in half. Is it in this pile?
No.
Okay. So I'll throw these out. Really, I should cut it exactly in half. Is it in this pile?
I think you're running out of questions.
I know. So how many? Connor says we better keep track of questions.
No, I think it was, I'm not sure.
Okay, I think I've asked two more.
Two? Was it? No.
After this one.
How many times did I?
It's your third time asking. Okay.
Yeah, so I've asked five so far. I think I'm going to win.
Sadly, it is.
Hmm?
It's in this pile.
It's in this pile. Now my pile is down to a royal, a straight flush here. I'll ask, is it Jack 10, 9, or 8 of hearts?
No.
I'll throw those out. One more question. Is it the ace of spades? Clubs. Yeah. Ace of, is it this card? Oh, you know, I may have, uh-oh. Is it the king of hearts?
Yeah.
It's the king of hearts. 5, 6, just in time, just in time. That was a little close. That was 9 questions. So please go ahead and play. So thank you, Connor. That was a great game. You played very, let's give him a hand here. Did a good job. Okay. I'll give you the deck of cards later, okay? Thank you. And while you're thinking of this, maybe some of you can multitask your math brain and your English brain at the same time. So I'll ask you why, and if somebody knows, just raise your hand and we'll bring around the microphone if we can. Why the name is, if you know why the name is Carol, raise your hand. And I'll tell you it's an anagram. Carol is an anagram, so there are only 720 things to look at. So, but keep playing the game and think of the anagram at the same time. And if some of you figure out what the anagram is, then just raise your hand and we'll come over and do it. C-A-R-O-L-E. I wish this was mine. The anagram was invented, if you can call it that, by Ron Rivest at MIT. We were looking for a name of a player, and he came up with Carol. Okay, so let's see if we can get the answer.
Oracle?
Oracle! That's it! Oracle! You win the prize. So Carol is indeed the oracle. She gives the answers like the Greek oracles at Delphus, but you're never quite sure of what she's saying. A question over, can we get the microphone?
What do you do if if it's not obvious that there's a lie in the first three questions?
Well, I'll talk about the analysis of the game in a moment. That helped that I knew it was a lie in the first three questions. That made it, the psychology is that people lie early. The mathematics is a total analysis, which is very different. But I've played this game many times and almost invariably somebody lies in the first three questions. In fact, the answer was the King of Hearts. And the lie was the second question. So. Well, let me turn now. From playing games to being a mathematician, but it's not really a big turn because mathematicians love to play games. Mathematicians like to play chess, and they like to play Go, and they like to play Monopoly, and they like to play Risk, and they like to play all sorts of games. But here I want to analyze the game because the other thing, when they're putting on their professional hats, they want to say, well, they're not just playing games, but that they're analyzing the game. And I want to talk about an analysis of this game. And I picked the numbers very deliberately, 52 cards in the deck and 9 questions. But I'm actually, it turns out, I'm not going to give a strategy for Paul. I'm going to give a strategy for Carol. Because Carol, see, Connor's problem is he's an honest young man. Even when he lies, he's honest. But Carol plays an adversary, and what she actually does is, you know, she doesn't actually think of a card. She just answers in a way that is the most confusing, the most difficult way to answer. And here's a way that Carol can win the game with 52 cards. What she does is she makes a pile of mini strategies. Now, a mini strategy here was a mini strategy that maybe Connor knew in advance, I'm not sure, which was the card is the King of Hearts, and the lie is on the second round. So this is called a mini strategy, which is which card you're going to pick and when you're going to make the lie. Now, how many mini strategies are there? There are 52 cards, and there are 9 places to lie, but what's the most deceptive thing that Carol could possibly do? Not lie. So they're really, I didn't mention that in the game, but it's allowed that, yeah, I didn't give all the rules. It's allowed that Carol doesn't lie. Should have mentioned that. So there are not 9 possibilities here, there are really 10 possibilities here. So there are 52 choices for the card and 10 choices for the lie. So Carol makes in her mind, or Connor's mind, a stack of 520 of these mini strategies. Now it turns out the crucial thing for Carol is that 520 is bigger than 512. And who knows what's important about 512? Maybe we can get the microphone. Yeah, so 2 to the 9th.
2 to the 9th is 512. Yeah. There are 9 questions that you're asking. You can eliminate half the cards each time.
This is really what it's going to be. There, 2 to the 9th. Is 512. I've been thinking a lot about early education because I have a grandson that's 6 years old. And I think one of the things is, the crucial thing to me is friendliness with numbers. And one of the things we do is powers of two. And he's not proving the prime number theorem, but he knows the powers of two. And I think this is a good thing, so I'll just leave that personal experience to you. Powers of two are good things. If there are more than 512 possibilities and you've got 9 questions, forget about lying, you can't get the answer because each time you'd split the answers in two, and what if you got the wrong answer? You'd still have more than half the possibilities. Think of it with 17. You can't guess a number from 1 to 17 in 4 questions. You might be lucky, but Carol's an adversary, so she's not really thinking of this particular thing in advance. Rather, what she does is she has these 520 mini strategies up in her mind. Every time you ask a question, like say my first question is it a major suit? The correct answer is yes. You're not supposed to lie with this mini strategy on the first question, so you answer yes. If the second question is it a black card? The correct answer is no, but you're supposed to lie. So you say yes. For each mini strategy, It tells you what you're supposed to do. What Carol does is she doesn't really have a particular mini-strategy in mind. She makes the answer that keeps as many of these mini-strategies viable as she can. And she starts out with 520, which is bigger than 512. After one question, she's going to answer, so it'll be at least 260. After the second question, at least 130. After the third question, at least 65. After the third question, at least 33. After the fourth question, at least 17. After the fifth question, at least 9. After the sixth question, at least 5. After the seventh question, at least 3. After the eighth question, did I get it right? Maybe I got off by one. But you see the theory. The theory is right. That after nine questions, there'll be two possibilities. And the game is over. That's it. And so Carol has won the game because Paul doesn't yet know which of the two possibilities there are. So this is an example of a game that's maybe fun, maybe not. I enjoy playing it. Maybe not as fun as Monopoly, but it's still a good game. But it's an example of, as a mathematician, we try to analyze the game and to see what would happen. And the mathematics can get very deep indeed. Indeed, here we've only talked about Carol's side. We also should be talking about Paul's side, but that would be the topic for another talk, and I think I've talked quite a few minutes already. So let me just end with an anecdote about a story about Paul. And it's really the story that Paul Hoffman, one of the stories that Paul Hoffman told, and it really did happen to me. And I was a young mathematician. It was right here in Manhattan. There was a meeting of the New York Academy of Sciences. So this would have been just around 1970 or so. And we went up to Paul's hotel room. In fact, I know it was 1970 because my son played a critical fetal role in the story, as you'll see. So I went up with my wife, Mary Ann, to his hotel, and he was there with his mother. You saw some photos of that beautiful woman who was his companion for many, many years. And we went up to the hotel room, and my wife, who was 7 months pregnant at the time, so I can really say it was April of 1970, I know when it was, went into the other room with Paul's mother, who was learning her fourth language, English. And there were a group of 10 of us and Paul. And Paul was at the center, and we were all around in a circle. But not only were we 10 mathematicians, but we were in several different areas. I was working in discrete math. There was a group of people in probability. And if I recall right, there was another group of people in set theory that is completely different areas of mathematics. And Erdős was at the center of this conversation, which was really three separate conversations that were going on at the same time in these three different areas of mathematics. And this had been going on for quite some while, and I rather have to confess that I had somewhat forgotten my pregnant wife there. But then suddenly, Paul turned and said something in rapid Hungarian to his mother, which none of us understood. And later on, we found out what happened. It turned out my wife, and who is not Hungarian, was speaking in English with Paul's mother, and she was just learning English, and she had made some kind of grammatical error when she was talking. So it turned out that all the time that Paul was doing the three conversations with the 10 of us, he was also listening to his mother, and he heard the error, in her English and rushed to correct it. So I think when we talk about multitasking, we have to say that Erdős was way ahead of his time. So I think I, too, will stop at this point.
Yeah, if we could thank all three of our speakers tonight, James, Paul, and Joel, if you could stand up and if we could thank our speakers one more time. I also want to personally thank the Simons Foundation, who underwrites Math Encounters. Without them, this series wouldn't be here. We wouldn't be able to delight you all with an evening of mathematics. And I want to say that, as I think you may have gathered, the topic of tonight's talk was particularly meaningful to me. In fact, of course, Paul Erdős is really one of the inspirations that I draw this entire project from for the Museum of Mathematics, and is, the legacy, his legacy, and he helped me out at an early age to begin my life of mathematics. Is one of the main reasons I'm doing this and why I support the Museum of Mathematics. And I hope that all of you will join with me in supporting the Museum of Mathematics. We are, unfortunately, a struggling 501c3 charitable organization, which means that you should leave your decks of cards behind. It means that you should visit our website, where you can see some of the books of Paul Hoffman. We have those for sale. Or you could even donate to the museum. We'd appreciate that. And the other thing we would appreciate is if you take the slip of paper, the evaluation sheet that should have been on your chair when you came in today. It's got a single question which you can answer. And in this game, there's no lying. You must answer truthfully. If you could just rip one of the four lines to indicate your answer to that question and give it to one of our wonderful volunteers, and I want to, who's wearing a black shirt on your way out, and I want to just close by thanking all the wonderful staff and the volunteers of the Museum of Mathematics. Thanks, I hope you had a great time, and I hope I'll see you next time.
Best one so far. I like that new game that, what was it called again?
The game with the cards?
Yeah.
I'm not quite sure the name.
All right, well.
Paul and Carol.
Anyway. Alright, well, it was awesome, and the Museum of Math, best idea since a very good idea.
Mm-hmm. And what did you think about Paul Erdős?
Very devoted.
Very devoted?
Extremely.
Yeah.
I'm gonna tell all my friends that there was this guy that devoted his entire life to math, and spent literally 20 hours a day doing math problems.
Where are you gonna play the card tricks?
At Boy Scout camping. I like camping.
And what do you think it's gonna take for you if you want to go further in mathematics? What do you need?
Probably. A lot of more paper and pencils.
And what about skills?
Oh yeah, and a good college too. And then I might figure out the ending to Pi. Or something.
Maybe you'll be the one that discovers the twin primes, whether they end or they keep going.
I just don't think that they end.
You don't think they end?
No.
I think they keep on going, but somebody's got to prove it. Maybe you'll be the one that proves it.
Yeah. I'm bringing home the card. No, not the card itself, but the card game to my brothers. And yeah.
What do you think? How do you think they'll respond to it?
They'll go. Oh my gosh! You actually found that out. Or something. Or, wow. No.
Can you answer in less than 10 questions?
Less than. Yeah, if they can get it, or I can get it, in less than 9 questions. Because I think I can get my little brother in less than 9 questions.